Hi to everybody. I am Dr. Alamelu Mangai from Bharathasan Government College for Women, Autonomous College affiliated to Pondicherry University. In this session, you are going to learn about the most important managerial aspect. It is very challenging in each and every management system, that is their leadership. The main managerial function in any food service is that it has to enable to influence the group, and now you will understand why this leadership is very important in a food service institution. In this module, you are going to learn about the classification, the functions, the qualities of the leader, the leadership styles, and also the processes and the approaches of the leadership. Let's start to understand this module with the classification of leadership. Management authorities classify leadership into different categories. The following classification that I am going to tell you is based on the Personnel Research Board of Ohio University. The first classification is bureaucrat. These leaders sticks to routine, appeals his superiors, avoids subordinates, and remains apathetic. Next is autocrat, who is directive, expects obedience, subordinates tend to antagonistic to him. The third is the diplomat, who is opportunistic, exploits people. This kind of leader generally causes distress. The fourth is the expert, who is concerned only with his own field of specialization and treats subordinates as fellow workers. The last one is quarterback, who identifies himself with his subordinates even at risk of displeasing his superiors. With this classification, let us now understand the functions of leader. With regard to the functions of leader, Crutch and Crutchfield along with Balache classifies the functions as primary and secondary. As you see in this picture, the primary functions are considered essential to leadership as it is linked with the leader's position and his followers who are dependent on the leaders on the work-related matters. And the accessory functions may be assumed by the leader or assigned to him by the group by virtue of his position. Thus, the main functions of the leader is to set an organization's goal with reference to its internal need and external pressures, to integrate the needs of the individuals with those of the group and achieve the goals. Thirdly, to maintain industrial integrity and the organization's distinctive identity. Also, to resolve internal conflicts with voluntary cooperation are all concerned. With these main function, thus, an effective leader should be one who can make ordinary men to do extraordinary things, make common people to do uncommon things, and leadership is a lifting of a man's sights to a higher vision, the raising of man's standard to a higher performance, the building of man's personality beyond its normal limitations. A good leader should also possess some qualities. Let's now see the important qualities required for a good leader. First, physical and mental vigor. In order to work efficiently for long hours, a leader requires tremendous stamina and vigor. Emotional stability. Leaders should be rational and logic to analyze the various problems and should not be moved by emotion or sentiments to take appropriate decisions. A good sense of judgment is also a requisite of a leader. Third is empathy. A leader should be discerning of the followers' strength, weaknesses, and ambition and can give them the attention they deserve, he should also know his own and should be able to look at things objectively and from the point view of others. The next quality is motivation. A leader should create enthusiasm within him to motivate his subordinate. If a person is forced to do a job under a fear of punishment, then he would behave like a follower than as a leader. The other important quality is communicating skill. A leader should have good communication ability to persuade, inform, stimulate, and direct his subordinates. He should also have the ability to guide his subordinates to accomplish a particular task, to correct errors, prepare them for achievement, and offer suggestions. Sociability is also the other quality. A leader should be friendly, helpful, sympathetic, and easily approachable, and should win confidence and loyalty of the subordinates. Technical competence. A leader needs to have a thorough knowledge on the theory and practice of his job with regard to principles, procedures, and operations of a job. Apart from all this, he should also have other personal abilities such as conceptual skill, moral courage, flexibility of mind, and should have the ability to establish proper priorities. Now, we'll pass on to the leadership styles. The analysis of leader behavior is to classify various types of leadership into styles. The way by which he influences his followers. Based on the types of leader behavior, leadership styles are classified into 8 types as autocratic or authoritarian leadership, laissez-faire or free-reign leadership, participate or democratic leadership, bureaucratic or rules-centered leadership, intellectual or expert or functional leadership, institutional leadership, manipulative leadership, and paternalistic leadership. Let us look into the types one by one. Autocratic leadership. An autocratic leader is work-centered or leader-centered. He gives orders and insists to obey. Without consulting the group, he frames future plans, specifies goals, organizes work situation, sets the time frame within which the task is to be accomplished, gives directions, and imply on workers to give the progress of the task. Thus, in this style of leadership, all the power of decision making is centralized, as you see in the picture, where the A here denotes leader. A leader who relies on negative influences and gives orders that subordinates should accept are called strict autocrat. When the leader uses his power to disperse rewards to his group, he tends to be positive. And this style is often called as benevolent autocrat. In this kind of leadership style, it yields high productivity and develops effective human relationships. There is another type of style called as manipulative autocrat. Manipulative autocrat makes the subordinates feel that they are participating in decision-making process, even when he had already made the decision. There is a drawback in this leadership where the workers under an autocratic leader feel harassed, disturbed, and gradually may stop obeying his orders. But this kind of leadership has been successful for the management because it provides strong motivator to the manager. In future, it is likely to be effective because of the rising standard of the people, social awareness among people, and the new generation is less amenable to rigid direction and control, and workers have now started to look for social and egoistic satisfaction from their jobs. The second type of leadership is laissez-faire or free-rein leader. These types of leaders don't take lead and allow their followers to work freely. He motivates the workers and permits the group members to establish goals by working out the problems by their own. There is near total abdication of formal leadership according to the needs of each situation and is known as permissive style of leadership. Laissez-faire can be successful when the workers have a high degree of maturity. In case of less maturity level, the leadership will not succeed if we also don't have suitable task behavior. Sometimes, deprivation of social emotional support from leaders may make workers feel insecure and vulnerable. The third style is participative or democratic leadership. This leader obtains the acceptance with consultation of his group members before giving orders. He encourages in the process of decision making and implementation. He decentralizes managerial authority. He promptly checks and controls the member who opposes the interest of the group by means of system of rewards and punishment devised by the group. This type is based on the assumption that workers are all able, though not willing to perform the assigned task. There are some advantages in this type of leadership. They are: the ideas of the management are accepted, the employee's attitude towards job and the organization is improved, the cooperation between management and employees are increased, and the employee's morale is also increased. The complaints and the grievances are also reduced. The fourth type is bureaucratic or rules-centered leadership. This style is characterized by a high degree of reliance on rules, regulations, and procedures. The process of administration here in this style is reduced to a series of routine actions due to the leader's behavior. There will be no participation from the worker's side and they remain apathetic. Rules might enable workers to work without being emotionally committed to work. The fifth leadership style is intellectual or expert or functional leadership. The basis for this type of leadership is leader's individual knowledge and ability, regardless of age, sex, physical or other attributes. The workers look up to him for guidance and control for his special qualification of the job. He is task-oriented and spends his time on doing things faster and better. If his workers are not participatory as he, they feel frustrated and prevent from maximizing their own potential. In this style of leadership, the perception or group members ensures that the leader's talent and expertise are joined with the needs of the situation. Also, the leadership skills are usually transferable. In general, expert leader is by definition quite poor on the human relations front. The sixth type is institutional leadership. This type of leader may or may not be an expert in their field of activity. He wields power over his workers and may even derive power from his personality and behavior. Due to lack of expertise, he suffers a sense of inadequacy, which leads to inferiority complex and will involve him more in task behavior. Because his lesser relationship behavior, the workers may feel frustration and alienation. The next is manipulative leadership. The main characteristic of this style is the personal goals are reached by a manipulation of the employees. Employees' needs and desires are viewed as tools to extract performance. The employees would be manipulated by the leader so as to attain the goal. The employees are aware of this and become resentful and bitter. This type may be effective when cooperation and coordination have to be achieved on tasks which the previous leaders failed to motivate, or when highly motivated employees are needed for short duration projects. The last type of style is paternalistic leader. Here, leader is characterized by loyalty of worker in a warm and cohesive setting. The leaders are concerned with well-being of his followers and comes for their rescue very often. As concerned with relationship behavior, it becomes successful among workers who possesses job maturity. The competent and achievement-oriented workers feel frustrated due to lack of opportunity for showing initiative under this leader. This leader, like a banyan tree, gives protection to all, and he unwittingly creates conditions under which no follower can grow and able to realize his potential. And the most important aspect that you need to understand are also on the approaches to study these leaderships. To study the leadership, there are many approaches, and basically it is understood on three ways. One is traits or person-oriented approach. The other is situation-oriented approach. And thirdly, group-oriented approach. Let us now see the approaches one by one. The traits or person-oriented approach. Persons who are leaders are presumed to display better judgment and engage in social activities. The main emphasis here is on single leader and his characteristics. Starting from Greek and Roman historians, the leaders possessed certain magical qualities due to charisma. They owned their position owing to personal qualities and yielded power, regardless to the rules, procedures, which restrict the exercise of authority by non-charismatic leaders. After deep research, the trait theory or the great man theory of leadership assumes that leadership qualities are inborn or God-given. Some important traits of an effective leader are also listed. To name a few, the intelligence. Leaders in this style possesses the ability to think scientifically, analyze accurately, interpret precisely and clearly the problems in different perspectives. The next trait is physical features. The important factor in determining the success of leadership is physical feature and level of maturity. Is inner motivation drive. Leaders have inner urge to keep on accomplishing something at proper time and correct initiative. Maturity. Leaders don't become victims of circumstances. They have high frustration tolerance and balance temperaments. The next trait is vision and foresight. Leaders should imaginatively visualize trends and should have foresight to devise programs and policies. Acceptance of responsibility. A leader is always aware of the duties and obligations associated with his position and should be ready to shoulder the responsibilities. The next one is open mind and adaptability. Flexibility is another name for this trait, as the leader would accommodate other viewpoints and adopt new ideas and views according to the situation. Next is self-confidence. This is essential to motivate and boost the morale of his workers, as he has conceptual clarity about the things to be carried out. The most important one is human relations attitude. Leader always tries to develop social understanding with other people in order to achieve the goals, as the cooperation of people is highly necessitated. Fairness and objectivity. Leaders should be free from bias and prejudice. Honesty, fair play, justice and integrity or character. Objective in dealing with subordinates is also expected from a good leader. The personal traits are only the part of the whole environment. There is no sure connections between traits and leadership acts. A leader may be successful at one point due to some traits, but may fail in another. Thus, measurement of a trait occurs after a person becomes a leader, and it becomes difficult to advocate the traits which are the prerequisites of a successful leader. The next approach is situational approach. In this situational approach, in order to study the leadership, he recognized that leadership is based on interplay between task behavior, relationship behavior, and maturity level. Task behavior is the amount of direction provided by a leader. The relationship behavior is the amount of socio-emotional support provided by a leader. And the maturity level is the readiness shown by the followers in performing a specific task. Leadership is widely dependent on many factors, such as the leader himself, the followers, and the situation, that include the values and traditions of the organization. The effectiveness of the group, the nature of the problem at hand, or in the co-workers, job demands, organization, tempers of the times, or also the other environmental factors in the situational approach. As you view in monitor, these are the factors that the organization should have for a leader, followers, and the situation therein. The leaders, thus, as you are seeing, should have own value system, should have confidence in subordinates, should own leadership inclinations, should have feelings of security in uncertain situations, also should have independence, dependence, need. For the followers, having the willingness to assume responsibility, have tolerance for ambiguity, should possess interest in participating, should have wide knowledge and experience, have expectations, and should also have values and traditions in the organization. The situation may be with group effectiveness. So understand the nature of the problem and the pressure of the time. With all these factors, the leaders perform certain behavior. For instance, task behavior includes goal setting, organizing, directing, and controlling. Relationship behavior on his part would render proper support and encouragement to people, hold discussions, and listen to the workers' opinion and grievances. The third and the last approach is group-oriented approach. An extension of situational approach is this group-oriented approach, where the leadership is viewed as the performance of those acts which help the group to achieve its preferred objectives. Bain and Sheets sets out 27 leadership roles as follows. For the group task roles, they list the leadership qualities as initiator, contributor, information seeker, opinion seeker, information giver, opinion giver, elaborator, coordinator, orienter, evaluator, critic, energizer, procedural technician, and also as recorder. For him to maintain the group building and maintenance role, they list him as an encourager, harmonizer, compromiser, gatekeeper and expediter, standard setter, and ego ideal, as well as group observer and commentator, as well as follower. With the individual roles, they list the leaders as aggressor, blocker, recognition seeker, self-confessor, playboy, sometimes as dominator, help seeker, and special interest pleader. In order to obtain the various objectives, the leaders hence have to play more than one role as listed and also allow their workers to take a right direction. I would now like to conclude with regard to leadership that without effective leadership in any organization, it is very difficult to function effectively. A person can be a leader only when he is successful in influencing and motivating his subordinates to work enthusiastically to accomplish the set goals of any organization. Hope in this session you have cleared the different aspects on the topic related to leadership. Continue to read the points to ponder and other quadrants.